Good evening, ladies and gentlemen.
Good evening.
It's a pleasure to be here again. The last time I was here was late 2016, when we just discovered, or the first year that we discovered the BAM gold. We, both Glenn and I, came out of Brancote in 2002, and we were foundation members of Landore Resources Canada. We funded it up to 2005. We sorted out the wheat from the chaff. And then we started to do the geophysics and drilling, taking some nickel, copper, cobalt deposits through to NI 43101 resources. And we'd achieved that by 2007. Now, the nickel price then was going up quite rapidly to, in fact, it reached $50,000 a tonne at one stage. But we did our resource, all of our resource work, $18,000 a tonne nickel equivalent. We then, once it reached, you know, high levels, we started to take it towards the pre-feasibility level. We did a lot of work there. We took the property containing that into a mining lease, which is essential to go forward into pre-feasibility. We did a lot of studies, baseline studies, metallurgical studies, and we reached a point where we were about to jump into pre-feasibility, and the nickel price tanked down to $7,000 a tonne, which is well and truly below what we'd hoped. So from there on, we just did various drilling programs around the property to see whether it, you know, we could establish the geology, and we did that very successfully. And then in late 2015, we were very fortunate that we turned the drills around and went on the other side of a gabbro unit called the Grassy Pond Sill, and we struck 50 metres of gold in the first hole. So naturally, we went straight back in, and in the first year, we proved up around about 300,000 to 400,000 ounces of compliant. And when I say compliant, I'm talking about NI 43101, with all the QA, QC done, everything done to establish that it was a mineable product. And that's the way we've taken it forward since then. So I'll take you into the, I'll look at this because I can't see that. But that's the important notice that has to go through. But this is the main slide that we're doing. We've just achieved this. We, like everybody else, struck a COVID problem in early 2020. In fact, it stopped us dead, and we had to establish a lot of infrastructure up on site to look after our First Nations workers and look after the drillers. And we didn't get going again until nearly October 2020. So between 2020 and late 2021, we carried out a good drilling program, and we succeeded in taking the resource up from 50% from the 2019 resource. We're on a highly prospective Archean greenstone belt. Now, most of the deposits in Canada are on Archean greenstone belts. And these, typically, you try to establish an open pit resource so you can go in there and exploit that and earn enough money to go down into the deeper areas. And all Archean ones that I know in Australia and in Canada go deeper, up to 2 kilometres deep, up in Pickle Lake, those sort of things. So first of all, establish good open pit and good geology. You must know your property. We've had a high drilling success rate of 21 ounces of gold for every metre drilled on the BAM zone. We got a low discovery cost of $11.45 per ounce. Now, putting that into concept, in Canada, the average is $40. We're down in the lower quartile. So we get 21 ounces of gold for every metre drilled and $11.45 per ounce. In the world, the average is around about $60. We've got $1.5 million ounce gold resource, including $1 million in indicated category. Now, you're not going to go anywhere unless you try to take your exploration targets into inferred, and then your inferred into indicated. Indicated sufficient to take it into pre-feasibility study, and that's what we are doing now. We're looking at that. We've We've taken that 1 million ounces of indicated into an open pit optimization, which we've just completed, and it's got 22.4 million tonnes at 1.16 gold, containing 833,000 ounces of the 1 million ounces of indicated, using a long-term price of $1,800. Excuse me, I just have a little drink. Thank you, Glenn. Our 2022 PA summary is pre-tax NPV at $1,800 gold, 333.6 pre-tax, with an IRR of 87.4. That's quite exceptional, and it's because it's got really good metallurgical recoveries. We've got a post-tax NPV, $1,800 gold of 231 million, an IRR of 66.7%. I don't always like to have both of those because most companies that are either looking at us or even us will have their own tax regime when we go in. So I like to quote both so you can see that as far as we're concerned, we have good tax credits and we go closer to the pre-tax exercise. After tax, simple payback of 1.25 years from the start of production. Now, we've optimised these pits so that we have starter pits, and I'll show you those later on, but basically we are pulling in up to 60-70% of our profits in the first 3-4 years. And that's essential in this. This has got a mine life of 10 and a half years, but we think the gold price is going to continue up, and as it goes up, we can then make more profit, we can enlarge the pit, that sort of thing. And so we're making sure we've got starter pits, and I'll show you them. It's an after-tax, I said, of 1.25 years from the start of production, 2.25 years from the start of the project. We're obviously in a politically secure and mining-friendly area in the centre of Ontario. In one of the top 10 mining jurisdictions of the world. We've done a lot of work in there. We know people. We know how to take things forward. Most of my staff are First Nations. They come from 2 to 3 local bands. I say local, they're within a 100-kilometre circle. And they've been with me for 17 years. So, you know, we've got a very good relationship with them. And that's essential to go anywhere there. Just the same, actually, as Australia, but it's good to do the right thing to start off with. Now, this is the most important map of the lot. We're on this greenstone belt, which you can see it's green, and that is called the Sub-Uchi Belt, coming right the way from Pickle Lake, where they produce nearly 100 million ounces of gold, and heading down towards Sudbury, where they produce a lot of the base metals. You can see the red line, where that's 33,000 hectares of property, which is large. When we first went there, we had around about 4,500 hectares. And one of our prime things was to explore and take up land that we could see, not necessarily on the ground, but by geophysics or satellite imagery. We did all of our work, and we've got what we consider to be the most prospective land in this area. There is a shear zone that goes for 400 kilometres east-west. And what it does in our property, it goes through between two large granite, and you can see the pink granite intrusions there, and it does a kink there. And we think that's got something to do with the concentration of the metals we do have there. The government has done a soil sample, till sample, survey from one end of the property to the other, but they've also extended out over 100 kilometres, and we do have one of the best areas for something like 8 metals, including nickel, copper, cobalt, and just so happens gold. We've got the grassy pond sill that I talked about. That's that blue sill going down the middle of it. We've traced that now for 20 kilometres, and what we have is that sill was by its definition. It was a flat volcanic eruption coming out as a sill, and it's been stood up on end, and hence we've got base metals at the bottom of it to the south. And so we're very lucky that we're seeing, we can look on the south of that grassy pond sill at the conductors that are there and continually hit the nickel, copper, cobalt base metals down there. And on the north side, we're also lucky because the shear acted between the mafic to the north of it and the gabbro and gave us a shear averaging around about 100 metres wide all the way through there. And it's full of sediments, and our discovery was in those sediments. And there are no sulfides in that at all, whereas on the bottom of the sill, it's all sulfide. It's massive sulfide, and it's the sort of sulfide nickel that we're all looking for, perfect for battery metals. So there at the moment, we've got 1.5 million ounces of gold. We've got Lamaune Gold, which is a lookalike, 11 kilometres to the west. We've got lots of sediment samples and drilling right the way along that area there that is bounded by the yellow boundary. And that's the area now, 7,500 hectares, that we've taken into mining leases. So we're all prepared, and we do, like I say, a lot of baseline sampling. Like, for example, water sampling. We've been doing water sampling now since 2007, and that's very essential if you want to go forward into mining. So we have Golders looking after all of their baseline studies, and we go through that systematically each year. In fact, they start their next study in a week's time. That's the resource. It's low grade, it's 1 gram, but we have 98% recovery. We won the 2016 Discovery of the Year Award because all of those large companies that we have around us, they all need to renew their resource every year. Whatever they produce, they've got to renew it. And we've got a lot of large ones around us. In addition to that, a lot of the Canadian companies have retreated from areas that, from the rest of the world, because of the political uncertainty in those areas. So we have potentially a lot of people around us that would like to get hold of our resource. And they have been watching us since 2016. In fact, they were party to that award. So we do have, we send them all of our information. They've got CAs, and they do their own modelling. So this is very essential if we, you know, reach our end goal of passing this on to a larger company and rewarding the shareholders that have put up with this for the last 15 or 20 years. And so the other thing is that we also have a lot of medium-sized ones looking at us at the moment. Block model 2019 on the right-hand side, it had 1,015,000 ounces back in late 2019. We carried out two programs since then. We managed to get back in October 2020 after we'd done all the infrastructure and the protocols for the COVID outbreak, and we drilled mostly through 2021. We were held up there again with a second belt of COVID, which severely impacted the First Nations. So we had to be cognizant of those items. But we managed to increase our resource by 500,000 ounces. It's very uniform. Every time we target, we come up with the same grade. When I say the same grade, I'm talking about the same average grade. This is the band. That's over around about 4 kilometres, like 3.5 kilometres. And that's the BAM zone so far. We've been exploring up to 20 kilometres. But this is where we've drilled, what with this and the B47 and the VW, something like 95% of our drilling is in this area. And you can see here two areas, the addition in the pit resource in the centre there, and towards the right, towards the east, down that end, you can see another circle there. where we resampled the grassy pond sill, which is the hanging wall over the top of the sediments. Now, previously, we've been sampling the sediments completely, and we were sampling some sections in the grassy pond sill where we could see these shear fractures going through it. And what we did last year, we decided to go back and have a look at that grassy pond sill and sample some more. Well, we had a pleasant surprise because we've gained another 200,000 ounces just in 400 metres in a 3.5 kilometre section in that. So right at the moment, my geologists up there are resampling the grassy pond sill, and that's in the hanging wall, and appreciate that that's what we strike first. It's closest to the surface. So we're looking at that because that's been a really valuable addition. So we could enlarge this, bam, by quite a few ounces without even doing another drill on it. We are going to drill on it because we've got areas there that we want to drill.
We've got 3 minutes
left. Sorry?
3 minutes.
Wow. That's not fair. No, that went fast, didn't it? So I just quickly flip through this. There's a cross-section at 2700 showing that hanging wall on the on this side that was picked up. And it, there was a 21 metre there at 2.5 grams. So you can imagine how much that's improved us. It also allowed us to go down deeper into the footwall area. And that's where we struck the 471 grammer and a lot of 1 ounce material in that that we'd hoping to go underground. I'll quickly go through this. That's the same thing. It looks like a submarine, but you can see a blue line there, which is the bottom of the indicated at the moment, and the purple is what they consider to be inferred. So as the gold price increased, we can take that down. We're down to 200 metres now. We can go down. If it goes to 2,000, we can go another 100 metres. This is all going online, by the way, so you can see it there. But project physics, physicals for this preliminary economical assessment. Contained gold mined, 832,000 ounces. I've said that before. I'll go straight on to the economics of it. At $1,800, you take out $1.5 billion worth of gold, okay? And we are going to, we have a project break-even gold price of $1,289. You can see the project NPVs and the IRRs, and we have a 2.25-year before we actually start putting in the money. Excuse me for a second. These charts show that if the gold price increases by 20%, your NPV goes up to over $500 million. So this whole project is tied to the price of gold. As that goes up, then we get more gold out, obviously, because we go deeper. Now, these are those starter pits that I was telling you about. The two starter pits there, this is at $1,800. Price goes up to 2,000, then they all start to join up. And that's what we're doing at the moment. The program this year is to drill in between those pits and to... Mine went very fast, Sarah. This has underground potential, and I explained that to you before. There's 50,000 ounces there at 3.6 grams per tonne that haven't gone into the resource figures. These are underground potentials at the moment, and we're going to start going down on those chutes. This year, we start drilling them. So they're definite chutes, we know they're there, and it's got good underground potential. Now, I think, if you like, the rest of this, most people have seen before. This is a metallurgical assessment. Very important, 98% extraction of gold. We've done extensive metallurgical testing on this in Vancouver. The big thing about it is there's 65% recoverable by gravity. And the remainder is all very fine gold that comes out within 6 or 7 hours in a standard type CIL plant. It's got low cyanide consumption, very low actually, very low lime consumption. So it's a simple processing path, path maximum recovery and low capex and opex. And I apologise if I waffled on a bit at the start, but I thought you needed to know those things. So as far as we're concerned, we can keep taking this forward. But what we really need, we've had a little bit of a hold-up with the COVID, but not too much. We still improved quite dramatically. But these are some of the mining leases. You can see those. You can see the baseline studies that we've done. And we have good access. This can go forward quite easily to a 3 or 4 million, 5 million ounce open pit alone along this 21 kilometres. And I had hoped to show you that. We've also got the B47. This is the B47 deposit, okay?
You just said 5 million there, Bill.
Yes, I did, and I meant it.
So what we haven't got to in any great detail is the strategic review, of the Canadian assets. So you're entertaining a sale of the Junior Lake project, particularly the BAM. You consider a joint venture deal, a strategic partnership, or some kind of combination. But what is it that the pair of you really want? What do you really want?
I mean, first of all, the reason it's come about is basically we believe we've reached that stage where the resource is at 1.5 million ounces, which is very significant, putting aside the base metal potential. So it's an excellent time, we think, for one of the larger producers in North America or Australia to come along and take the project forward. Obviously, our share price is disappointing, so a part of the decision has been the fact that if the value of the company is not being reflected in the share price, then it should be reflected in a corporate transaction that, you know, hopefully we can achieve over the next few months. But it's, you know, it's a significant project, significant stage, and we just think it's ready for one of the larger companies to come along and take it off our hands, or some form of corporate transaction. It's early days yet.
Because Bill, you're not a big softie, you're not a pushover. You've done something like this before, a corporate transaction. So are you going to get the shareholders a good deal or a great deal?
Look, we're both significant shareholders in this, and we've been in it a long time. We want a great deal. It deserves that. As far as I'm concerned, this project has the potential to be as big as Brancote, Eskil Gold Project, and that was a great deal for the shareholders. We want this to be a great deal for the shareholders. And it's been held down for a couple of reasons. And one of them, Glenn's done a marvellous job of taking this up from a low stage up to, 40p and that. And we were climbing up towards what we felt was a realistic sort of 60, 70p type mark. And then somebody came in and sold his whole 12%, bang, one day, that was it. So since then, there's been ping-ponging backwards and forwards. And that's not helped by the fact that we have an overhang of some 16 million warrants. And once they're cleared in a month or so, I think everything will improve dramatically.
So what happens if you raise the cutoff grade? I'm just curious how that deposit behaves.
One for you, Bill.
Well, once you raise a cutoff grade, you lower the tons coming out. But there's been...
You do have higher grade...
We have... Oh, yeah. No, we do have pods like that. And we could go underground right from 100 metres down, for example.
But about the open pit, how does that look?
Well, the open pit, they'll optimise that. Now, the next stage is pre-feasibility, and it gets optimised in that, and they determine what level you take that down. But open pit mining is so much cheaper and gives you a quicker return and much easier than underground mining. And this is a logical one where you take it down as deep as you can, profitably, and then you take it down. It'll go down on a slope. It's going to be very simple underground.
And what's the strip ratio?
This one is 8-1, which is, the engineers have determined that is the right level.
Okay.
What's the capex to put in a gold mine?
What is the capex to put in a gold mine?
Well, this one. This
one, you mean? Well, at the moment, it would start at around about 80 or 90 million. But that's because we've already tried to source a crusher and, you know, some of the main parts. So my thoughts are that that could creep up to 120 million by the time you get going. Now, it's obviously going to take 3 years in Canada from the time you press the button on your pre-feasibility. But you can see already that we've got a lot of our pre-work done, the licenses and a lot of the studies done. So we're ready, actually, in the nickel as well. The nickel copper is just the same position. We could step into pre-feasibility with both tomorrow.
Okay, sir, please.
Thank you. One of the things I think probably held the share price down is concerns over funding for drilling should a sale not come about. Clearly, you've got these warrants which will, you know, potentially provide some funding in July. Can you share your thoughts on that?
Yeah, the funding situation, we're well placed in the sense that a lot of the May, well, all the May warrants were exercised. So we collected, I think it was about £1.5 million from that exercise. We sold off from Imaniska, a small property, which has been a good little deal. We've had some cash in from that and stock. I think we've got another $250,000 next month in cash and $3 million Canadian in stock value. Which obviously we can't go and sell straight away, but we've got a good relationship with management, so hopefully we could place that. So that's the immediate cash, and then obviously the July warrant, $16 million, representing £3.2 million of potential cash coming in. A little unpredictable. We've made inquiries, you know, just last week, or this week actually, to see if we can find out what people intend doing. Just because of that uncertainty. Difficult for us to guess. Eric Sprott's half of that in warrants, so we'll be seeking to get a, you know, get a view where all these people are sitting. You know, conservatively, if half came in, you know, we'd still be well placed. But it is an issue because obviously we can't predict what people are going to do, even though we're optimistic. Would help if the share price was higher again. Because, you know, we're trading at 22, warrants exercisable at 20. So it's a little marginal. But as I say, the May warrant holders are in the same position and they're all very supportive. So once we can clear that as well, because obviously some of those warrant holders, someone like Sprott, I expect, would exercise and hold. But some of the others exercise and sell day one. But as Bill said, originally we were up to 40p. A year or so ago, the other problem we had was, you know, word of that financing came out through not leakage through Cenkos, but the Cenkos financing. So immediately went down to 31, 32, forced to do a financing at 30 with warrants. Then we drifted, and then our largest shareholder sold, you know, 10, 12 million shares or something over a matter of a couple of days. So that hurt us, and we've sort of been sort of stuck between the 20 and 25 mark since, albeit the market hasn't, you know, hasn't been great for anyone. So, but yeah, hopefully. But as I say, the process we're going through with the strategic review, you know, it's a ridiculous valuation at the moment, 25 million sterling when we've got 1.5 million ounces gold plus. So any deal we're going to do we hope is going to reflect the true value of these assets, which is obviously way, way, way more than the market cap at the moment.
Okay, so we're overrunning slightly, but final question, Patrick.
Hi guys, it's Patrick. We expect the board are very excited with the uplift in the resource, but equally, we expect you won't be having unrealistic expectations of the value. So may I ask what matrix you're using to determine the valuation of our company? And are we going to value according to our MRA and PEA? And will our share price dwell heavily on any negotiation during the anticipated sale process? Really what I'm saying is that, I mean, it's probably the 100 to 150 million pound question. So what do you think we're worth?
Well, everyone would have a view. You can base it on US dollars per ounce. Obviously, some people base it on our share price. Cenkos have valued us at 68 million pound recently, 53p, which is fairly conservative. Sorry, Bill.
That's without the base metal?
Yeah, you know, it's a fairly conservative estimate, we believe. But obviously through this process, it's going to be, you know, the very best that we can obtain. It's such a subjective matter as to what I wish we had a crystal ball, but it's going to be a lot.
Yeah, so if you can just briefly talk about the metrics that you're using towards, you know, an ideal valuation, and then that.
Is it going to be MREPEA? Is it going to be share price?
Well, do you want to comment, Bill? It's not that specific, because obviously interested parties are going to do their due diligence. They're going to assess the value. But obviously, you know, you could take ounce for indicated. Not sure what the going rate is. Depends on jurisdictions. We had a company in Australia sold last year to Remelius Resources, very similar resource to ours, similar grade in Australia, good jurisdiction, the same as we have. That sold for about 180 million Australian, which is about 100 million pound. Another little deal that was done recently, Oklo, Australian company, that B2 Gold have picked up 600 odd thousand ounces. I think it went for 90 million Australian, so 50 million pound. So
that's what we would typically do is have a look at all of the sales over the last 2 years of similar open pit projects. And believe it or not, there's quite a few out there. So that would be the one that we'd look at. But price per indicated for gold, we look at the average of that and for the inferred, and also give a value for the nickel and the prospectivity. So all those things we'd be looking at.
Thank you. Bill and Glenn, thank you very much indeed.
Sorry,
thank you. Well done. Don't worry.